Good morning, Emily's Hecker. Elian Gonzalez's great uncle says the Miami family will not return the boy to his father. We have the latest in a live report.
Good morning, I'm Scott Michael Traeger. Detroit police say they arrested a man that could be responsible for serial murders around the globe.
Good morning, I'm Chris Williams, live in Grand Traverse County. We'll introduce you to a Northern Michigan man whose kayak company is going to help save local watersheds.
And good morning, I'm Jim Lee Hockey, and for Dan Lee, we're looking at some precipitation passing on through the region. We'll check out the radar pictures coming up in a bit.
Plus, we'll talk live with a dietitian about the benefits of tart cherry juice for people with arthritis.
And another trial in the murder case that inspired the TV show The Fugitive ends in a guilty verdict. It's Thursday, April 13th, 2000.
From Northern Michigan's most watched station for news, Elise Hecker, Scott Michael Traeger, and Dan Lee. This is Michigan This Morning, Northern Michigan's number one way to start the day.
Just a few minutes before 7 o'clock on Michigan This Morning for a Thursday. Chris will be talking more about canoes coming up in just a few moments.
Not going to want to really plan a canoe trip. Well, I guess
maybe not.
Kind of.
Maybe not today. We'll see a little bit of snow, some precipitation. But, you know,
you're doing some bailing.
That's true. Really. Some bailing. But that's, you know, some of the streams and lakes have some water in them. But we are looking at, let's check out your wake-up weather this morning. We're looking at a little bit of a mix across the region, developing some snow across the eastern UP by mid to late morning. By this time going home, we're looking at temperatures mainly around 40 across eastern UP, 55 for Mount Pleasant, Big Rapids, with, again, we're looking at partly to mostly cloudy skies and a few rain showers throughout the afternoon. And your radar picture, there it is, some light snow heading west to east. We'll take another look in about 10 minutes.
A protester outside the home of Cuban refugee Elian Gonzalez went to jail after he tried to push over a police barricade this morning.
About 200 demonstrators are camped outside the Little Havana home. Many are praying and vowing that Elian won't be taken away. Attorney General Janet Reno demanded the family bring Elian to an airport this afternoon for a flight to Washington to be reunited with his father. Kathy Moss is live in Little Havana this morning with the very latest on our top story.
Well, U.S. officials say today is the day when Elian must make a move that his relatives here still appear to be fighting.
Defiant to the end, Elian Gonzalez's Miami relatives brought him back to the Little Havana house he has called home for so many months. They say they will not turn him over to his father.
This man is not going to betray the trust that that child has placed on him.
Their late night, almost triumphant return to this neighborhood brought out throngs of supporters. Supporters who have relentlessly held vigil here for weeks. It has also brought out authorities who vow to keep the peace. The move followed a long meeting between the family members and Attorney General Janet Reno herself. She flew to Miami to meet personally with them, hoping a one-on-one session would convince them to travel to Washington for a reunion. Instead, in a much-anticipated letter, she has issued an ultimatum. The family must bring Elian to a small nearby airport by 2 p.m. local time.
It is now up to them to ensure that Elian's transition from their care to the care of his father, Juan Miguel Gonzalez, happens in the best and least traumatic way.
And so the Justice Department is making it very clear that it is prepared to enforce its ultimatum so that Juan Miguel Gonzalez can regain custody of his son. We're live in Miami. Kathy Moss reporting. Now back to you.
702 on Michigan This Morning. Detroit police believe they have a worldwide serial killer behind bars this morning.
We knew we had someone in our community who was going to victimize someone else. And we put sufficient resources in the area that we believed that he was going to be working. Very alert patrol officers who spotted him, stopped him, and we arrested him. This person was going to kill again.
Police arrested a 26-year-old man yesterday in connection with three bodies found along railroad tracks in Detroit Monday. Investigators believe the suspect, a former Navy sailor, committed the murders and others around the world. Police say the man lived in a suburb of Detroit for about 8 months and has traveled extensively. According to both the Detroit Free Press and the Detroit News, police say the suspect told officers that he killed four women in the Detroit area, as well as women in Virginia and Washington State. Investigators also linked the man to killings in Thailand, Hawaii, Singapore, Hong Kong, Japan, Israel, and Korea.
Northern Michigan police will continue their search for thieves who broke into veterinary clinics looking for a drug that's a derivative of the date rape drug. Yesterday, one clinic in Cadillac reported drugs stolen. This past Monday, thieves broke into a clinic near Ludington. And in February, one in Mount Pleasant was broken into. Veterinarians are afraid they've become targets for thieves wanting to get high on ketamine, a hallucinogenic known as Special K. According to investigators, thieves stole about 30 vials of ketamine from this Cadillac clinic. A second Cadillac clinic was also broken into, but nothing was stolen because the drugs were hidden away. Vets are afraid more break-ins will happen.
You feel violated, yeah. It's just, we shouldn't have to be this concerned about, you know, the things that we use, but we do, and that's why, you know, everything's got to be lock and key and hidden away.
According to vets, one vial of ketamine will knock out a 1,000-pound horse for half an hour. Police do have some leads in the Cadillac break-ins. Police believe two people in jail could help investigators solve a rash of more than 70 break-ins. Police arrested two men for breaking into two homes in Newaygo County. Today, investigators hope to make more arrests in connection with all 70 break-ins. Those arrests, combined with this home video of a break-in, make police optimistic they are on the right track. Police don't know how much information the suspects have about the other break-ins or if the suspects were part of the other robberies. But police have something which is much more than they had a week ago, some clues in this troubling case.
I believe this is a good first step, but it's a tall staircase with this many crimes committed over this period of time. And we're not talking about one lone suspect who's out there doing this. We're talking about multiple people, multiple crimes, multiple counties.
The thieves took everything from guns to stereo equipment. Police believe the 70 break-ins are connected somehow.
The parents of a first-grade girl shot and killed by another classmate near Flint promised to cooperate in legal action surrounding the girl's shooting. Shooting happened in February at Beecher Elementary School in Mount Morris Township just outside of Flint. Since the shooting, later lawyers for Kayla Rowland's parents have been squabbling over who should be named personal representative for the girl's estate. Tuesday, a judge settled the dispute and named the girl's mother. The mother's lawyers will act as lead attorneys on the case. The father's lawyer, Jeffrey Feiger, will play a secondary role. The agreement clears the way for both parents to seek monetary damages for their daughter's murder.
I hope that if passed, that the judges will have the courage to use that law.
State lawmakers want judges to get tough on drunk drivers who kill. State Senator William Van Riegenmorter just introduced a bill that would let judges punish drunk drivers with separate sentences if more than one victim dies. In 1993, three Traverse City High School students, Jason Stutzman, Kendra Tiernan, and Aaron Tompkins, died in a drunk driving crash. A judge sentenced the driver of the car, Jash Lardy, to 7 to 15 years in prison. A father of one of the victims supports Van Riegenmorter's bill to give tougher sentences to drunk drivers.
I feel that the judges and the authorities should have some more leeway in dealing with people who are willing to go out and gamble with other people's lives, basically. And if people continue to gamble, then raise the stakes.
The Senate Judiciary Committee plans to begin hearings on the bill sometime next month.
A Northern Michigan woman says her boss fired her because she told him that she wants his job. It's the job of prosecutor for Osceola County, which this year is on the ballot. Assistant Prosecutor Sandra Marvin told her boss on Tuesday that she planned to run for prosecutor. She says he fired her on the spot. James Tulaski says he wanted to rehire her, but only if she decided not to run against him. Marvin said no.
I've been working in the office it's been a little over 4 years. I see a need for a lot of changes. And I was hoping when I went into that office that I would be able to make some of those changes as assistant prosecutor. However, it hasn't worked out that way.
Tulaski says he couldn't allow Marvin to continue working in his office because he didn't want the election to cause friction among his staff. Members of a Northern Michigan Indian tribe want to oust two-thirds of their leadership council. The dispute is happening within the Little River Band of Ottawa Indians who own a casino in Manistee County. The tribe currently uses casino profits for social programs like health care and housing projects. But some tribal members want cash instead. Those members gathered petitions hoping to get rid of six tribal leaders and hold a new election. According to the tribe's attorney, a federal contract forces the tribe to spend the money on projects instead of making direct cash payments.
7:08, Michigan This Morning.
And still to come this half hour, Chris joins us again live from Grand Traverse County, where you will meet a man who makes canoes that may help save northern Michigan rivers.
Plus, a northern Michigan woman planned to give an animal shelter a lot of money. Find out at 7:29 why the woman has changed her mind. And at 7:43, you'll meet a Michigan State University dietitian who says drinking sour cherry juice could help people suffering from arthritis.
Now, she means juice from tart cherries.
Right, from tart cherry, right.
Not that you have to drink sour cherry juice.
I'm sorry, she's from Mercy Hospital. She's actually not from Michigan State. No, it's the tart cherry juice. But, you know, the tangy, you know, when you drink it.
If you put sugar in it, would it, like, delete the...
I don't know. We'll find out.
That'll be a question. We'll find out. All right, Jim Lee Hockey was wondering the exact same thing because I saw the look on his face over there.
I just liked Elisa's.
Oh, yeah. Well, isn't that what you do when you eat a tart cherry?
I usually get the like that.
Yeah. But the chills.
And it's chilly out there right now. We'll check out temperatures in just a bit. The jet stream is going to support some warmer temperatures heading into the weekend, but also a chance for some moderate to heavy rainfall. Not so much across our region as the energy should stay toward north and west along the southern branch of the jet stream, but it will pass on through the UP. So anytime you are near that jet stream core, there's a chance for some light rain, but I think the heaviest of the stuff will remain to the north and west. Satellite and radar picture all across the nation. Some heavy rains across the Tennessee Valley and the lower Mississippi Valley. A little system for us will pass on through the region today. Some light snow, a light mix across the eastern UP and far northern lower Michigan, eventually changing over to all light rain from north to south across the region. But then we start to see the jet stream change, and that'll give us some warmer temperatures for the next few days. Closer to home, here's that system again. It's not a big one across Wisconsin, maybe an inch and a half on the accumulation totals for the eastern UP and the Straits area, I'd say sometime later this morning into the early afternoon period before it starts to mix with some light rain. But further south, it goes some light rain for Big Rapids, Pentwater, Hart, Mount Pleasant, and Clare, and Cadillac. Otherwise, again, behind the system, you can tell it's clearing out just a bit, so tonight should be rather quiet. Right now, we do have temperatures 25 in Big Rapids, 31 in Midland, 25 Houghton Lake, right up I-75, 25 in Gaylord, 19 Pelston, and 23 in the Kinross area. Highs today again, despite the cloudiness, temperatures reaching in the lower to middle 50s across central lower Michigan, which is, by the way, just about normal. We're looking at highs in the 40s elsewhere, north of perhaps M55, M72, which is a little bit below normal. Lows tonight into the 30s and 40s, so a mild night. We'll see some fog and some drizzle because the atmosphere will be moist enough to support that, although where you don't see the fog and drizzle, we'll see perhaps a little bit of partly cloudy skies. For this afternoon, that system starts to work its way through the region. Tomorrow, we see that frontal system across the eastern UP, extending southwestward into northwestern Iowa. Anytime or anywhere north of that front, that's where we will see showers and even some thunderstorms. So as that system is really stationary across eastern UP, that might fluctuate just a little bit, spawning a shower or two, but that is just about it. Even for Saturday, it may sag a little bit south. So the eastern UP, the Straits area, could see a better chance for late Saturday and into Sunday. By the way, Friday and Saturday, dry across much of the lower peninsula. With that jet stream to our north, that's where the heaviest rain should be. Eastern UP and the Straits area for today, cloudy skies developing, some morning snow developing, then an afternoon light mix, highs 40 to 43. Tonight, mostly cloudy skies, evening light rain and some snow, probably 6 or 7 o'clock then ending, lows 33 to 36. And for the northern lower, today we're looking at the clouds moving in with, again, some morning mix developing, some afternoon light rain, nothing major, highs 45 to 50. For tonight, clouds break up, some fog and some haze, lows 40 to 46. And for the central lower, today we're still looking at some mild temperatures, actually just about normal. They're going to feel mild compared to the past couple days. Considerable cloudiness, some patchy light rain. And for tonight, becoming partly cloudy, some fog and some haze, lows near 43. And your Doppler 9 and 10 5-day forecast. Again, with that frontal system draped across the eastern UP and the Straits area, we'll see cooler temperatures to the north of that, much warmer temperatures to the south. Best chance for rain late Saturday and Sunday.
All right, thanks, Jim. 7:12, a northern Michigan man is using his skill as a canoe craftsman to save local rivers.
He's teamed up with an area conservation group to protect waters that his customers enjoy to traverse. Chris Williams joins us live from Grand Traverse County with 9 and 10 News Digital Skylink. Good morning, Chris.
Good morning again, Scott and Alicia. Yeah, a little bit earlier, we were just down on this side of the shop, and we took you through the process, showed you how things work to get to where the canoe and kayak is almost finished. And Larry Bordine is with us, the canoe maker. And Larry, take us, again, for our friends at home just now joined us. The kayak is almost finished, but it's not watertight, right?
That's correct. This is the final sanding here, the fairing that Nate is doing. and he's getting it ready for the layer of fiberglass that goes on next.
Show us this fiberglass, because it actually looks like a sheet, like a white sheet or something, and this is what's going to make the product watertight.
That's correct. This is a 6-ounce fiberglass, and once Nate's finished sanding it, we will put the fiberglass over the boat, and we'll wet it out with epoxy.
And it actually dries clear, like this boat here that's finished. This is how it ends up. And, you know, it's kind of interesting how that works out. Well, are you ready to take it out on the water then?
Well, once this is on, you're right, this disappears, and it won't even show when you're done. And we put one layer on this on the deck, and we have as many as 3 layers on the hull in places that are going to take a little more abuse from the landings. But once the fiberglass is on the inside and the outside of the boat, then we're ready for use.
Now, you're involved with a group called the Conservation Resource Alliance, and they raise money to try to save local watershed, local river. Tell us a little bit about how you're involved with those folks.
Well, every boat that we sell through them, we donate back between $300 and $1,000 to their organization.
And it's kind of an interesting way that you folks are involved with them, because your customers want to use the local lakes and rivers, and these folks want to save them.
Exactly. They preserve and protect the very waterways and rivers that these crafts are built for.
And these look really neat. I mean, they're very beautiful pieces of work, but they're actually made to get out there and bang up and take out there on the water.
Exactly. They're very durable. With the fiberglass inside and out, they can take a lot of abuse.
All right. Larry, thank you so much. We appreciate your time. And Scott and Elise, if you log on to 9and10news.com, I think we have a graphic that'll have the information for the CRA and Larry if you want to get in touch with him to buy a boat. And again, if you buy one through the CRA, part of that money will go to help save the watershed that you may use. So we're going to have some more fun in Grand Traverse County. We'll talk to you in a little bit.
All right. Sounds good. Thank you.
All right, looking for some precip coming up in the next few days.
That's right. Well, first off, for today, we have the radar picture that's going to be right there. It is putting it into motion. We do have some activity off to our west. It's not all that heavy. The white that you see with the blue mixed in, that's a little bit of a light to moderate snow. The pinks indicate some a mixture of rain and snow that's heading off to the east. And that'll pass on through the region today. But your 5-day forecast, some warmer temperatures finally for Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And even to early next week, temperatures just about where they should be for this time of year. So we need the moisture. Looks like it's on its way.
All right. Big win last night for the Pistons at home against the Miami Heat. We'll take a look at that, plus night 2 from the Copa after we check in with CBS. Going nowhere fast. Day 2 at the Copa in Detroit last night, and after a 40,000 fan sellout on day 1, reality set in on night 2. Baseball is a warm weather sport. Just over 21,000 on hand for another freezing cold night in Detroit. Everybody trying to stay warm. Please, Mother Nature, bring me some warm weather. John Olerud trying to become the first man to homer at Copa. No. No, it's off the 365-foot park. It's a double. Drives one home, 1-0 Mariners. 2 the sixth inning. 2 on, 2 out, 2-0 Mariners for Paulie Banez, who drives home 2 more with a slow grounder to right to make it 4-0. In the seventh, the Mariners and Aaron Seeley cruising along with a one-hitter. He gets a little help from A-Rod. Alex Rodriguez, the dive, the flip to Mark McLemore, who makes the turn for the double play. Seeley looking for a complete game, 3-hit shutout, and he will get it. No home runs again. No Tiger threats, in fact. Same 2 teams will wrap up the series tonight. Tim Hardaway in civvies for the Pistons in the Heat last night at the Palace, and oh my goodness, did they need him. Not on this play. Anthony Carter makes the pass to P.J. Brown to Alonzo for the jam, 2 of his 16, but elsewhere, Pistons just beat up on Miami. Jerry Stackhouse has a little bit younger legs, I'm afraid, than Dan Majerle. Blaine beat the clock and victimizes Thunder Dan to end the first half. And in the second, Stack run to the baseline, and he will hit the 3 ball in the corner pocket, finish with 29, and the Pistons cool off the Heat last night, 90-73. Say, this is going to be a developing thing that they talk about through the year. It is going to be extraordinarily hard to hit a home run at Comerica Park. 2 games, no home runs yet.
Right.
The Tigers' home run numbers are going to be minuscule.
Because it's such a great distance.
It is so far away. And so many, so there's probably 4 balls hit Monday, or excuse me, Tuesday, that would have been home runs at Old Tiger Stadium.
Ah.
That John Olerud would have been a home run at Tiger Stadium.
Wow. All right, 727 Michigan this morning. We have a 10-minute weather guarantee every morning. Jim's sitting in this morning for Dan Lee. Good morning.
Good morning, and we're delivering it quite nice this morning. We do have mainly partly cloudy skies out there right now, but the clouds are moving in from the west, and we have some precipitation to talk about now entering the Lake Michigan area. Let's check out what's going on out there right now. Temperatures across the board, 23 at the Sioux, 25 Traverse City, 23 in Cadillac, 25 in Alpena, 32 in Ludington. But off to our west, some warmer temperatures, 36 in Green Bay, 41 in Eau Claire. Doppler 9 and 10 radar picture does show, again, the pink that you see is a light mix of some rain and snow. Temperatures hovering around freezing around Milwaukee and Manitowoc, Wisconsin. But the snow across northern Wisconsin, the western UP, will be affecting the UP, eastern UP in the Straits area for later this morning. Amounts perhaps an inch to an inch and a half. That's just about it. But some warmer weather heading our way. We'll talk about that coming up in about 10 minutes.
All right. Thank you, Jim. Detroit police believe they have a worldwide serial killer behind bars this morning.
We knew we had someone in our community who was going to victimize someone else. And we put sufficient resources in the area that we believed that he was going to be working. Very alert patrol officers who spotted him, stopped him, and we arrested him. This person was going to kill again.
Police arrested a 26-year-old man yesterday in connection with three bodies found along railroad tracks in Detroit on Monday. Investigators believe the suspect, a former Navy sailor, committed the murders and others around the world. Police say the man lived in a suburb of Detroit for about 8 months and has traveled extensively. According to both the Detroit Free Press and the Detroit News, police say the suspect told officers he killed four women in the Detroit area, as well as women in Virginia and Washington State. Investigators also linked the man to killings in Thailand, Hawaii, Singapore, Hong Kong, Japan, Israel, and Korea.
Northern Michigan police will continue their search for thieves who broke into veterinary clinics looking for a drug that is a derivative of GHB, the date rape drug. Yesterday, one clinic in Cadillac reported drugs stolen. This past Monday, thieves broke into a clinic near Ludington. In February, one in Mount Pleasant was broken into. Vets feared that they had become the targets for thieves wanting to get high on ketamine, a hallucinogenic known as Special K. According to investigators, thieves stole about 30 vials of ketamine from this Cadillac clinic. A second clinic in Cadillac was broken into, but nothing was stolen because those drugs were in a safe. Police do have some leads in the Cadillac break-in. I know the Michigan woman planned to give an animal shelter a lot of money, but when county commissioners investigated the shelter, she pulled back the funds. The shelter is in Gaylord and Otsego County. Virginia Christian has worked with the animal shelter for 26 years. She planned to leave it $50,000 when she died. But recently, county commissioners began an investigation into the shelter procedures and the animal control officer. To show her frustration, she removed the donation from her will.
If everybody's got their nose in it, I don't want to leave the money. I don't know what it's going to be used for.
Virginia will leave the money to family members who will make sure the animals are cared for properly. One county commissioner says the shelter is not worried about the loss of money.
The parents of the first grade girl shot and killed by a classmate near Flint promised to cooperate in legal action surrounding the girl's shooting. Shooting happened February 29th at Beecher Elementary School in Mount Morris Township, just outside of Flint. Since the shooting, lawyers for Kayla Rowland's parents have been squabbling over who should be named personal representative of the girl's estate. On Tuesday, a judge settled this dispute and named the girl's mother. The mother's lawyers will act as lead attorneys on the case. The father's lawyer, Jeffrey Feiger, will play a secondary role. The agreement clears the way for both parents to seek monetary damages for their daughter's murder.
A proposed bill just introduced by a Michigan state senator could let judges punish drunk drivers with separate sentences if more than one victim dies. In 1993, three Traverse City High School students, Jason Stutzman, Kendra Tiernan, and Aaron Tompkins, died in a drunk driving accident. A judge sentenced the driver of the car, Jash Lardy, to 7 to 15 years in prison. The father of one of the victims says he supports the bill to give tougher sentences to drunk drivers. The Senate Judiciary Committee plans to begin hearings on the bill sometime next month.
Another Michigan woman says her boss fired her because she told him she wants his job. It's the job of prosecutor for Osceola County, which this year is on the ballot. Assistant prosecutor Sandra Marvin told her boss on Tuesday she planned to run for prosecutor. She says he fired her on the spot. James Tulaski says he wanted to rehire her, but only if she decided not to run against it. Marvin said no.
Been working in the office for, it's been a little over 4 years. I see a need for a lot of changes. And I was hoping when I went into that office that I would be able to make some of those changes as assistant prosecutor. However, it hasn't worked out that way.
Find out what the elements are.
Tulaski says he could not allow Marvin to continue working in his office because he did not want the election to cause any friction among the staff.
Well, Ray Pleva has shown the nation the benefits of cherries when he put them into his Pleva Lean Burgers. Now there's yet another way to get health benefits from cherry juice.
Some are saying that it can help you with your arthritis, so we'll have a story on that. A dietitian is going to comment on that coming up.
And at 7:57, Chris Williams again in the Bowers Harbor area this morning, talking with some people making some homemade canoes that will also, in turn, help the environment. We'll tell you why.
Here's a quiz. Where in the world do most strains of flu start? I'm Dr. Dina Dell. Coming up, I'll have the answer.
If you had the flu just once, you know how miserable it is. But did you ever wonder where it comes from or how it starts?
As Dr. Dina Dell explains, you have to travel around the globe to find out.
The flu. Influenza. We all know how it feels.
I had to stay indoors the whole weekend to sleep. I just didn't have any energy to move, and I'm still a little snuffly.
But do you know how it starts?
It actually starts out, it's felt in the animal world, in the chickens and poultry.
The Centers for Disease Control begins tracking the flu in Asia. Influenza begins in places where people and animals live close together. Birds pass on the virus to mammals, like pigs, who eventually pass it on to us.
CDC actually goes there every year and tries to predict what will the next influenza virus be, and that's how they make up the vaccine.
First, the influenza virus mutates, and then, thanks to the ease of global travel, it makes its way across North America, over the Atlantic, to Europe, then jumps the equator and heads south.
I mean, if you think about it, it's it's basically a life form that wants to keep alive.
Before vaccines, flu epidemics killed millions. Today, the flu is still dangerous. According to the Centers for Disease Control, it kills 20,000 Americans every year. It's always mutating, and there are many different strains. So how do you stop it?
That's your major way of preventing it.
And don't forget Mom's advice. Wash your hands as often as possible. I'm Dr. Dina Dell for 9 and 10 News.
We're trying to wash our hands of this winter weather and get back to more spring-like conditions.
But Robert already talking about some road construction out there. Good morning.
Morning, folks. Yeah, I tell you, boy, it will be really nice to get back to some spring-like weather. And supposedly it's on the way, and that's good news. And road conditions, well, they vary in the state. Let's begin in the Upper Peninsula, where that snow continues to head east. However, still pretty much in the viewing area, we're still finding clear conditions. So if you're headed out for I-75, expect to move well around St. Ignace and the Sault Ste. Marie areas. Just remember that continuing I-75 reconstruction project between the bridge and the US 2 interchange, down to one lane each direction. You'll find some slow traffic there, especially during peak travel times. US 2 is in pretty good shape. Posted speeds attainable in Mackinac, all the way over to maybe Delta County, and on M28, the shoreline route. Once again, clear conditions working. Be careful construction in the Hulbert area, Hulbert and Chippewa townships in Chippewa County. M28 construction there. I-75 beginning or scheduled to begin Saturday. Let me reiterate that. Scheduled to begin Saturday or early next week. They're going to resume that I-75 over the Indian River on that bridge project up there in Sheboygan County, so keep that in mind. 75, though, for the morning commute this morning looks clear all the way from Mackinac City down to Monroe. Head out for US 31. We're finding dry conditions at this time, and same story for US 131 in the northwest region. Heads up for folks on 131, a couple new projects underway, lane closures between Fife Lake Road and the Boardman Road area in Kalkaska County. Also, Charlevoix County, 131 Lynn Street to Thumb Lake Road up in the Boyne Falls area. Expect some lane closures there. Mid-Michigan highways look pretty good. 27 and US 10 are dry. Trouble-free conditions along the Lake Huron shoreline for US 23. And the secondary roads also dry. That includes M32, although watch for those barrels and construction slowdowns in the Gaylord area. M72 east and west of 75 looks dry and trouble-free. Same story with M55 across the region. And M115 also dry this morning from Clare through Cadillac as you work your way into Benzie County. That's the story, Jim. Maybe we can finally put the hat and gloves away?
Well, I don't know, Robert. We do have some snow just off to our west. We'll check out the radar picture in just a bit. It's not all that heavy, but we could see an inch and a half across the eastern UP in the Straits area for later this morning into the early afternoon hours. But we need the moisture, whether it's wet or white. We're going to see it over the next few days, especially across the northwestern Great Lakes area, northwestern Wisconsin, Minnesota. That's where the heaviest rain will be for tomorrow and Saturday. But eventually, this rain will replace the dry weather across Lower Peninsula for late Saturday night and into Sunday. Temperatures all across the region, mainly in the 20s and lower 30s. Mount Pleasant, 30. Muskegon, 30. Cadillac, 23. Mackinac Island, 30. And Sault Ste. Marie, 23. Radar picture, we do have the activity. This is all snow right here working its way from west to east. Some light mix of rain and snow in the pink air. We're looking at, again, perhaps later on this morning into the early afternoon hours. That's what we can expect. Nothing big. But again, a warming trend heading into the upcoming weekend. I'll have more coming up in just a few minutes.
All right. Thanks, Jim.
A couple of first and tens for you today. We will begin with Michael Kuhn from Harrison. Mike's turn and ten today.
And Michael Brines from Petoskey, turning 10 today.
And the Michaels share their birthday with Reverend Al Green, 54.
Yeah, good morning, Scott and Elise. I'm live in Grand Traverse County. Again, we've been talking about these canoes all morning. A little bit later in the show, we'll show you where you can pick some up a little bit later, so you want to stick around.
There may be some good news this morning for people suffering from arthritis. According to researchers at Michigan State University, sour cherry juice contains 10 times the anti-inflammatory relief of aspirin without irritating the stomach. Now, drinking tart red cherry juice is a folk remedy, however, and is not clinically proven for treating arthritis. Joining us live this morning to talk about the benefits, the possible benefits of tart cherry juice is dietitian Tammy Swihart from Mercy. Good morning. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Now, you're saying tart cherry juice can do a lot of things for our bodies.
Right. It has what is called a pigment power, mm-hmm. and lots of fruits and vegetables have this type of thing. It has a bioflavonoid called anthocyanin, mm-hmm. and that is the key to the benefits in the coloring of the tart red cherry juice.
But people should not just rely on something that, I guess, used to be a folk remedy to treat their arthritis. They should see their doctor, wouldn't you say?
Correct. There is research, as you had stated, through Michigan State University, a physician mm-hmm. by the name of Dr. Neer, that is investigating the benefits of the anthocyanin in the tart cherry juice. And those are also included in strawberries, plums, mm-hmm. blueberries, and blackberries.
I guess this also goes back to the fact that we are supposed to eat a lot of fruits and vegetables.
Correct.
All of us, even if you don't have arthritis.
Correct.
Anyhow, we have, here's the nutritional breakup, I guess, of tart cherry juice. It has a lot of calcium in it too, it looks like.
Yes. This is a concentrated form of mm-hmm. the cherry juice, and what is recommended is 8 parts liquid to 1 part of the concentrated cherry juice. And you can mix this with different things such as squirt is recommended or
okay.
diet carbonated beverages okay. for anyone that possibly has diabetes. They may want to stay away from the strong sweet drinks. Also, water is a great way to dilute the cherry juice.
Okay, so cherry juice facts, it's an excellent source of antioxidants. You were talking about the chemicals that prevent inflammation. They say that it may reduce the pain associated with arthritis, and it has a potential to stop the growth of colon cancer tumors. Is that also part of this study?
Yes, it is. They're looking at rats mm-hmm. and studying rats, and also, it has antioxidant powers, which help protect against heart disease, different various types of cancers. Just, it's a wonderful thing,
yeah.
and it's all natural, so.
Should we be careful of the natural sugars in it, though?
No.
Is there a lot of sugar in tart cherry juice?
There is not much sugar in there. Actually, you want to look at total carbohydrates.
Okay.
All carbohydrates turn to sugar in the body.
Right.
And I did a little bit of mathematical calculations, and it breaks down into less than 5 total grams of carbohydrate okay. per serving.
Wow. All right, Tammy Swihart, thanks for joining
Thank
us
you.
This morning. Interesting news. All right. Scott, Jim?
All right, Jetstream is changing for us, isn't
That's it? Right. You know a little bit about the Jetstream, how much of the activity that we see is right along the Jetstream, and this is what it looks like heading into tomorrow and Saturday. The southern branch of the Jetstream will come in from New Mexico into Nebraska, southern Minnesota, then across the UP. Usually, the precipitation associated with the jet stream is right along that or to the northern side of it. We also have the northern branch well to our north. A little cutoff flow across the Tennessee Valley will not really affect us. But because of the jet stream across the eastern UP, the lower peninsula is looking dry. for the most part for the next couple days. Any rain showers for tomorrow and Saturday should be limited to the eastern UP and the Straits area, but by late Saturday night into Sunday, that's when the entire viewing area could see some beneficial rainfall, and that could continue into early Monday morning. Temperatures on Sunday, iffy right now, but the main thing right now is that we're going to see all liquid stuff and pretty much no snow as it looks right now.
Okay, Dr. Bernadine Healy is going to be talking about some alternative medicines next on The Early Show on CBS. Michigan This Morning.
Yeah, I love James Garner.
Oh.
It's a great thing for Chicago.
It's the first of its kind for the state of Georgia, and there's really only a few other cases in the U.S.
Doctors at Emory University in Atlanta owe all the gratitude to a device used as a bridge to heart transplants. April Nelson has more.
Hey.
Hi.
You doing okay?
Very good.
Your x-ray looks good.
Debbie Davis has made medical history. She's the first patient in Georgia and among only a few in the country to have a failed heart that repaired itself.
It's a miracle in itself that I'm here.
Debbie was transported from Albany, Georgia to Atlanta back in January when a case of influenza A got so bad it caused her heart to fail.
Well, it got where I couldn't walk from one room of my house to the other without having to lay down.
Near death, Debbie spent 2 months at Emory Hospital connected to a device like this called a biventricular assist. Two of them kept her alive by literally taking over the function of her heart while she waited for a transplant. But because she was so far down the list, doctors knew she would die while waiting. Dr. David Vega decided to remove the device from Debbie's chest so she could go home. What he discovered was amazing. Her heart had fixed itself.
With the experience with these devices, we've realized that they can support patients for an extended period of time safely and allow the patients not only their heart to recover, but the rest of their body to recover.
Except for some scar tissue, Dr. Vega says Debbie's heart has made a complete recovery. As for Debbie herself, she says she's a little weak and stir-crazy because under doctor's orders, she hasn't been able to do much. But that's about to change.
Dr. Vega, as you know, has just released me to do anything I want to today.
What are you going to do? What's the first
drive? Drive.
April Nelson for CBS News.
It's a good view from up here.
Another Michigan fraternity climbs to new heights for a good cause. The dedicated group of men sat on top of a pole 40 feet in the air for 4 straight days. The pole sit took place on the Lake Superior State University campus in Sault Ste. Marie. Mark Shelter sat on top of this pole yesterday for 2 hours. But he's not alone. All brothers in the Delta Sigma Phi fraternity took turns on the pole, and they admit it got a little rough.
Pretty high. It gets cold at times with the wind and everything, but other than that, it's not bad. Once you get used to the height.
It's real bad when it starts raining up there because there isn't any place really to go, and the tent blocks a little bit, but it still gets wet inside there.
Oh, the brothers say the rough conditions are worth it. All the money raised during the pole sit will benefit the March of Dimes.
The American Film Institute honored actor Harrison Ford with the Esteemed Life Achievement Award. Last night, George Lucas and Steven Spielberg presented the award to Ford. The ceremony looked back on the 35 motion pictures, including the most successful movies of all time, which comprise Harrison Ford's body of work.
Apparently he was quite, you know, humble about them.
Yeah.
He's kind of embarrassed.
He is a nice guy. He's a good guy.
Yeah. Chris Williams live this morning on the Old Mission Peninsula. Good morning again.
Good morning again. I thought maybe you guys were going to tie into me saying I was a nice guy for a second there. So, I know what you're thinking. Why are we in a cherry orchard standing in front of a kayak? But with our digital sky cam, we can actually pull in the bay, and we're looking at the water there, and we're thinking, you know, might not be a bad day to go out there. We were talking about these kayaks all morning with Larry Bordine, and how much do these kayaks weigh?
They weigh between 40 and 45 pounds.
And we've got a couple of guys here who they're actually going to pick it up, show how light it is. Larry, we appreciate you showing us how you do your business. Again, if our friends at home want to log on to 9and10news.com, we have some information about the CRA that you're involved with, raising money to help out the environment and the local waterways, and many of you're giving money for when people buy boats, you're actually donating a lot of that money back into the environment. We really do appreciate that. Now, Scott and Elise, tomorrow we're going to kind of do a change of pace. We're going to Mount Pleasant. Some students at CMU have a swing dancing club. They're going to show us what that's all about, and it should be a fun time. You know, Count Basie and some of that music. We're going to have some good time in Mount Pleasant. We'll see you tomorrow.
Sounds good. Thank you. And also some last minute tax tips this weekend.
Yeah.
Is it?
If you have some questions, right, Hopefully we can get some answers for you.
I would like to see Corey, the photographer, photojournalist.
Oh, swing dance?
Swing dance. Tomorrow, Mount Pleasant. That's a challenge.
Put in the request.
That's a request. Let's check out the radar picture. Actually, that's a jet stream across the region. The radar picture does show some activity heading our way for later this morning.
All right. Thank you, Jim. Thanks for joining us. Have a wonderful morning. We'll see you back here in 25 minutes.
Two toll-free ways to call the 9 and 10 newsroom when you see news happening. Cellular One customers call star 910. Regular customers call 1-800-star-910.